I call this meeting the Williamsburg James City County School Board to order. Can I get a motion for certification of closed session?
I certify that to the best of each member's knowledge, the Williamsburg James City County School Board, while in closed session, discussed only public business matters lawfully exempted from open meeting requirements as stated in Virginia law, and that only such public matters as were identified in the motion convening the closed meeting were heard, discussed, or considered.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? It's been moved and seconded for certification of closed session. Ms. Serza, can you take the vote, please?
Aye.
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 With that, I will call to order the public hearing on the pre-budget. Are there any, I have no speaker cards for the public hearing. Does anybody wish to talk about the public hearing for the budget? Seeing none, we'll close the public hearing. We'll move to 4.02, the Pledge of Allegiance. We have with us Brandon Taylor, 10th grade student at Lafayette High School. If you could come forward and lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance, sir, I would appreciate it. The microphone's right there. Don't come up here and take mine.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Mr. Taylor. I appreciate it. Ms. Serza, could you take the roll, please?
Here.
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 Thank you. Approval of the agenda. Can I get a motion for approval of the agenda as presented?
Mr. Chair, I move approval of the agenda as presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Ms. Serza?
Aye.
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 Aye. Announcements and superintendent's reports. Dr. Constantino.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good evening, everyone. A survey is now available on the division's website, wjccschools.org, to collect input on the proposed 2016-2017 school year calendar that the board has reviewed. The video of the school board's January presentation and the accompanying documents are linked on the survey page so that our staff, families, and students and community members will have access to background information prior to completing the survey if they wish. The survey will be open until February 2nd, and results of the survey will be shared with the board. A parent academy on career exploration will be held January 27th from 6 to 8 p.m. at the Williamsburg campus of Thomas Nelson Community College. Parent Academy is a division-wide initiative designed to promote engagement by offering families information and resources that support student development and achievement. This initiative seeks to provide strategies to help families become stronger advocates in their child's education and to build successful partnerships with schools. To pre-register for the Parent Academy, visit the division website and click on the Parent Academy slide on the homepage. As I know you're aware, the newly formed WJCC Schools Foundation awarded over $28,000 to 33 teachers earlier this month. Two school buses full of foundation board members, donors, and school board members, past and present, were on hand to travel to our schools and surprise teachers and students with the awards. We have posted many pictures on the division website and on the Twitter accounts. Thank you to Mr. Kelly, Ms. Cook, Ms. Hummel, Dr. Beers for their attendance to this great event. I know the foundation is already working toward a bigger and better award season for 2016-2017. Mr. Chair, those are all the announcements I have this evening.
Thank you, sir. Does any board members have any announcements that they'd like to make at this time? I would just like to reiterate a couple of things that Dr. Constantino talked about, the proposed calendar survey. We've done the survey in the past. We didn't get a lot of response as far as which options the teachers and the community were interested in. Primarily revolves around, do you want 3 days of Christmas, or 3 days of Thanksgiving and 2 weeks at Christmas? So that's kind of the the big decision there. And then the Apparent Academies, I've attended several of the Apparent Academies, and they're really great resources. A lot of good information is presented at those meetings, and so you really should look at attending. This is one for those who are in high school and going to the end of that. And then the foundation, Dr. Constantino did say that several board members went for the presentations. It was really a great thing, great presentations. The teacher's reaction was great, but what also was good was the foundation donors who attended, who participated in it, and they were really very excited about it. And I think the foundation has been exactly what we expected it to be and wanted it to be, which is not only a resource for our teachers to do things innovative, but also a way for the community to become engaged in our schools. So I think that's has met all those goals. So I look forward to next year, and hopefully we'll be bigger and better even next year. That brings us, any other announcements? Brings us 7.01, board recognitions. I think we have a few tonight.
Good evening, Mr. Chair. Tonight we have a number of individuals to recognize. Let's begin by recognizing Jamestown's Alexa Halko for being named 2015 U.S. Paralympic High School Track and Field All-American for the 100, 200, 400, and 800 meter races. Alexa also holds the U.S. records for these races. She was one of the youngest members of the team and is currently ranked third in the world. Alexa, please join us up front to be recognized for these extraordinary accomplishments. Lafayette High School theater students were named VHSL, Virginia High School League, conference champions for their one-act play, The Yellow Boat. This is the ninth consecutive year that the team has competed in the state competition. Would theater teacher Suzanne McCory please come to the podium to announce our students? There she is. Good evening, Ms. McCory. Students, as your name is called, please join us up front to receive your certificate, and please remain for a group photo. Ms. McCory?
Thank you, Dr. Constantino and school board members, for the recognition of Lafayette High School Theater. This past fall, we performed our VHSL one act, The Yellow Boat by David Sarr, and we are very happy to announce we're going to perform it one more time on Friday, February 12th, to the community at the Williamsburg Regional Library. I would like to call up our not only our state winners, but our district champions, as well as regional champions and state champions. Sarah Aldred, if you can come up to the podium, please, when I call you. Sarah Aldred, Maddie Botts, Emma Brandt, Zoe Igbo, Grace Granger, Alejandro Gonzalez, Jessica Garrett. Oh, I am going way too fast. I am sorry. Maddie Botts, Zoe Egbo, Grace Granger, Alejandro Gonzalez, Jessica Garrett, Jordan Hines, Hannah Cottrell, Jean Mamoreau, All-State winner Jack Mills, Sarah Pettingill, Emily Ryder, Emma Rote, All-State, Jacob Schumacher, Luciano Saporito, Matthew Stankus, Astrid Stanley, Christine Strong, Eric Stump, Brandon Taylor, Tanner Tassone, and Whitney Woods. Congratulations, Lafayette Theater.
Congratulations again to Lafayette's Theater, and Ms. McCrory, thank you. Now let us recognize several Lafayette athletes for being named to All-State teams. Students, please join us up front as your name is called and remain for a group photo of all of the athletes. Blaine Jones and Tiana Little were named to the VHSL All-State Competitive Cheer Team. Hezekiah Grimsley and Joe Cragenbrink, Trey Neville, Chayton Pine, and Kyle Johnson were all named to the All-State football team. Several members of War Hills Girls Volleyball Championship Team were also named to the VHSL All-State Team. These talented young ladies were recognized last month as members of the War Hill team, but we asked them to return to congratulate them for this individual accomplishment. Ladies, as your name is called, please come up front to be recognized. Corey Clifton. Nicole Mulligan. Jewel Walters, Chloe Wilmoth. Additionally, Coach Gregory Kuhn was named VHSL's Coach of the Year for the second year in a row. Coach Kuhn, please come forward to be recognized and join the lady for a photograph. Thank you. 5 WJCC Governor's School students have been named best in state and best in region in the Verizon Innovative App Challenge for the development of an application concept called Math.io. These students won a $5,000 award for the Governor's School for Science and Technology program and an LG G-Pad for each team member. The team advanced to compete for the 8 Best in Nation awards, which will be announced February 2nd. Will Jamestown's Tim Felbinger, David Thames, Lafayette's Dominic Abundanzo, Noah Miller, and Josh Peterson please join us up front to be recognized? Tim. Come here, Tim. Can we still vote for you?
Yes, up to January 31st.
Tim, would you go to the microphone and tell everybody how they can help you advance to the Nationals? Mr. Chair, if you don't mind, we'd like to get anybody who can to vote. Tim, turn around and speak into the microphone so we can see on TV.
Okay.
They can hear you.
All right, so in order for us to win the national competition, part of it is to get votes. So the way to do that is to text MathIO2 to the number 22333.
Oh, if you didn't hear that, you can text MathIO2. What's the number again,
number
Tim?
22333.
The students could really use your support, and we'd love to see them be national champions. Thank you, Tim, very much for doing that. Join me in congratulating Tuano teacher Ronald Trainum for being named the 2015 Middle School Physical Education Teacher of the Year by the Virginia Association for Health, Physical Education, Recreation, and Dance. Ron continued to compete against teachers from 10 states to earn the District Teacher of the Year title and has advanced to compete against 3 other individuals for the national title. Ron, please join us up front to be recognized for this wonderful accomplishment. I have to go back out to congratulations. I have to go back out to Tuano and try to beat Mr. Trainum in the pacer test.
2 weeks away.
2 weeks.
2 weeks.
It's not a lot of time. The Association of School Business Officials International awarded WJCC the Meritorious Budget Award for the 2015-16 budget submission. This is the division's 10th year participating in the program, which promotes and recognizes excellence in school budget presentation. Christina Berta, please come up to accept this award on behalf of the exceptional efforts of our finance department. Ms. Berta. And WJCC also received honorable mention award from the Chesapeake Chapter of the National School Public Relations Association for distinguished achievement in the category of special publications for the Portrait of a Graduate infographic. I'd like to ask Betsy Overcamp-Smith and Ronnie Showa to come forward to be recognized for their outstanding work in developing effective communication tools for our school division. So this is like the first time Ronnie's going to be in a picture and not take it. Congratulations. Yes, Mr. Chair. Also, as the chairman and the vice chairman take their seats, I'd like to add just a, a superintendent's recognition to announce that school board chair Mr. Kelly's recent graduation from the Sorensen Institute Political Leaders Program. This prestigious leadership opportunity is offered through the University of Virginia for Virginians seeking to be more active in public service, and we'd like to congratulate Mr. Kelly.
Thank you, Dr. Constantino. We're getting ready to move on to the next. Let's go ahead and do student spotlight.
School spotlight this school month spotlight. Is going to feature Lafayette High School, and there he is.
I am here.
I was trying to hold people hostage for you, but I think they want to make an exit, so we'll let them. If there are people.
Really, it's not going to be that bad.
It's a great program. I've been there myself.
Don't take it personally.
So trying to rush home to watch it on TV, so you're good.
Home in time for Wheel of Fortune.
Is that still on? Oh, absolutely. Yeah. So. All right, Dr. Constantino.
Yes, thank you. This evening, Lafayette High School, Ms. Swinton is here, I think, as well. And would you like to say a few words about the program? All right. Then Mr. Adol, one of our great teachers at Lafayette, will kick off our program this evening.
Thank you very much. Good evening, Dr. Constantino, members of the board, and those who may be viewing. I'm Richard Adol, technology teacher at Lafayette High School, where I've been there for 34 of my 35 years with WJCC. With the coming graduation, I'll be 40 years graduating from Lafayette High School myself. So it's been a quick trip. I'm here this evening by the request of my principal, Mrs. Swinton, to really talk to you about another outstanding program. As you can see, we got a lot of outstanding programs at Lafayette that have been recognized this evening. 3 years ago, I got involved with a program called Virginia STAR, which stands for Virginia Student Training and Refurbishment Program. That's a mouthful. It started by Prince William County up in Northern Virginia, and it's whereby schools could receive discarded computers, hardware, and things like that, that could be refurbished by the students so they get some training, as well as they give the opportunity to give these back to the community at no cost. Currently, there are over 60 schools involved in the state of Virginia. The Virginia STAR program has been so well received that funding has been allocated at the state level and dispersed through the SPARK program, which is also part of the Prince William County school system. By invitation this morning, I was privileged to meet at the General Assembly building, and where I was able to visit the offices of both Delegate Pogge and Monty Mason to go in and kind of peek in and ask them to encourage the addition of $50,000 more to the fund for Virginia STAR. And so we hope that that will pass, and we believe that it will. Our efforts at Lafayette were recognized this morning in a luncheon, being one of three schools for best practices in the state out of the 60 different school divisions participating. And with that, got a little plaque and $2,000 also to spend on more hardware, software, or whatever is necessary in order to promote this program. The last 2 years, we managed to complete and deliver about 60 computers to local agencies, churches, after-school programs, apartment complexes, and individual families. This year alone, in one evening on December 9th, we assisted the adoption of 53 computers and 40 new printers, and we still have potential to give out another batch before the year is over, so we're looking forward to that. This was only made possible by the relationship with Virginia STAR, our own IT department. Thank them, the coordinator of family and community engagement, the Lafayette student advancement coach, and the LHS administration. Because of the local IT connection, we were able to process in 1 year what took 2 previous years to accomplish. So we're very grateful for that. Part of the goal for Virginia STAR participants is to become self-sustaining. So I greatly appreciate continued support by our division by allowing us to be the beneficiaries of displaced technology, particularly laptop computers. During our adoption event, families and organizations came to Lafayette, where about 20 of our students greeted them and presented to them an overview of what we did in order to prepare the laptops, including cleaning, software, and preparation of owner's manual. At this time, I'd like to share a 3-minute video prepared by my friend and mentor, Hoyt Davenport, who himself taught 45 years and worked with WJCC, after which I've invited a couple students to share thoughts, and then Mrs. Swinton, our principal, will follow up. Thank you very much.
But with Virginia Star program, student refurbishment computers, we basically got these computers in from Prince William County. We also got them from our own IT department. The task that the students needed to do was basically take the computers apart, clean them, check the condition of the parts. Some were missing keys. In some cases, we were able to order new keyboards with the funds that we received through Virginia Star. We took time to load Windows 7, open source software, and a virus protection for temporary protection. As a vital part of the Virginia Star program, it's the interaction of the students with the people who are adopting the computers, as we call it. So this evening, we invited several folks from the community who we knew could use a laptop computer or use technology in their home to come in to receive one of our computers that we had repaired.
We're giving away over 60 computers tonight for free to the community.
Did you say free?
Yes, free.
Bridging the Gap is an excellent opportunity as us students to give back to the community.
I'm just here tonight just showing how giving our computers to people that need them and how we can help them. There's owner manuals and stuff like that to show how the computer works. And yeah, we're just trying to do our best to help out.
When the computers came in, many of these computers were missing keys, some even missing like software. And so we stripped them down, cleaned everything, and then installed new like Microsoft Word, Office kind of thing.
Hello, I'm just saying thank you for the blessing for the printer and the laptop. This program is really going to benefit my family. You know, we'll be able to get online and connect with other things. My daughter will be able to, you know, do her homework and be successful in school. So I just wanted to say my thanks to the school. And this is one of her Christmas gifts, so I really do appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Also with that, we were able to provide for them if they needed a printer and a cable in order to get on the internet. And we also recommended to them Cox Communications and other providers who will provide at a reduced cost internet or broadband access. As a part for the students interacted with each of the people adopting the computers and explained to them the work that had gone into cleaning the computers and preparing them for them personally. With each one, they received a handbook that we put together. Also took time to see if they needed any kind of instruction in order to use the computers and reminded them once again that if they were going to place these in service on the internet, that they needed virus protection.
This is such an awesome program, and I just want to take the time to thank the students, Mr. Adol, and the technology department for refurbishing these computers so that we are able to give back to our community.
Hello.
Good evening.
So I got called up here to talk about Virginia Star.
Sounds like a good volunteer to me.
And I really enjoyed like taking apart the computers and fixing them, and that was fun and all. But what I really liked was the faces of the people that I gave them to, because they were there and they're getting these free computers and they couldn't afford to get them themselves. And to get the computers and to get printers and to get all this information, and these are refixed, everything 100% free, and for them to hear that they get to keep it, that was just really nice for me to just do. It really like warmed my heart to be able to do that. And
great.
So I really appreciated the program.
Great. And in the event your mom's watching, your name is?
Oh, Alejandro Gonzalez. Thank you.
Helping you there.
Hello, I am Brad Snodgrass. I'm junior at Lafayette High School. And I just wanted to say it was great to give to the community. I mean, Mr. Adol showed us how to clean up everything and get it ready for everyone to use. And then we just gave it to them, showed them how to use it, gave them their printer and their power cord and booklet.
Thanks much. I know those families are very appreciative, and you know, it's a great program. I can't stress enough how appreciative I am for the service that provides to the community. So, Ms. Swain?
Good evening. I just want to say, again, thank you to Mr. Adol and the students. I really didn't have to do anything with this program. There was just a total commitment from the very beginning. He took on definitely the role as a teacher leader, and he got students who were truly committed because of his leadership, and they became very engaged with what they were doing. And as I was moving around that evening talking to students and talking to families, I kept asking them, well, what role did you play and why are you doing this? And they talk about the little things that they did, but the one thing that stuck in my mind the most is that they were helping the community. And that's what I see with a lot of students at Lafayette. We don't hear about students being concerned about the community and helping, but that night really demonstrated that. So that's something. And they also got to collaborate. And I really appreciate that we also got to collaborate not only with the community, but also with central office, just trying to organize this and make it the best possible program. So again, I thank Mr. Adol and the students for all the time, because they put in a lot of their own time bringing this program to Lafayette. And I know it's going to be even greater next year. Thank you.
Are there any questions or comments from board members? Ms. Hummel?
I would just like to say that programs like this are a win-win-win-win-win in so many different ways. It's a win for the community. It's a win for the students who are able to collaborate with people and learn skills and then learn the joy of giving back to the community. It's a win for the school and for teachers like Mr. Adol, who can see the bigger picture and actually make it all work. It takes work to pull these things off. It takes work to make this magic happen. So I just want to say I love the whole program, and I'm looking forward to seeing how it grows.
Well, I must also give kudos to Ms. Hyland, because she really worked with getting the community organizations, finding them so that they could come in and pick up several computers to help their organization move forward as well. So thank you, Ms. Hyland.
Yeah, and then any other board members?
No, I just think it's an amazing program. And you talk about magic when you don't have a computer, and we live in an age of technology. To have one is definitely an asset.
Dr. Constantino?
Thank you. Just two real quick things. First of all, Mr. Adol, thank you. Many, many years ago, when I was in Prince William County, Chuck Drake approached me and said, would our school like to be involved in this new program called Virginia Star? And we said, sure. He said, we're going to drop off a few computers to you and the kids can work on them. I said, that sounds great. And if you know Chuck very well, he's a very energetic, exciting guy. And the next thing I knew, there was a 10-wheeler pulling in with hundreds of computers. And in those days, they weren't laptops. They were giant computers, and dumped them on our loading dock. That was the moment I realized what we had bought into, but it was a great program. Secondly, I can't think of a better example of 21st century learning. You know, we talk a lot about the curriculum redesign and all of the things that we're doing to help our students work in the 21st century. We understand that it's problem-based learning. We understand that it's project-based learning. We understand the math and the science and the physics and all of the things that they learn. Plus, they're also getting social skills, they're getting community skills, they're getting problem-solving skills, they're getting group skills. And I really can't think of a finer example than what you've provided us tonight in our efforts to promote that kind of learning. So thank you very much.
Yeah, I can only reiterate all of that. And while I think one of the most rewarding things from your point of view, Mr. Adol, is, you know, Ms. Swin said a teacher leader, but I saw in that video several student leaders who, you know, taking the leadership to do the work and present those computers and the reward that you get from doing that. I think that was an amazing thing. So I appreciate your hard work and your energy to keep that program at the stellar program that it is. So thank you. Thank you, Mrs. Swin. That brings us to agenda item 8.01, citizens' comments. Dr. Beers.
It is at this point in our meeting where citizens are invited to address the board. Those citizens desiring to speak have submitted speaker cards to the clerk prior to the start of tonight's meeting. These These speakers are asked to come to the podium when their names are called, state their names for the record, and direct their comments to the chair of the board. It is the board's interest and desire that all comments are heard and respected. Hence, the citizens are asked not to engage in applauding, verbal outbursts, or any type of demonstration during the presentations. Personal matters are not considered in public meetings. Therefore, the board requests that all speakers refrain from making reference to specific individuals in any form or fashion. Though the board does not respond to your comments are heard and appreciated. Each speaker is allocated 3 minutes to make their presentation, and the board asks that you respect this time limitation. Also, please be reminded that no time may be yielded to another speaker. Your acceptance and adherence to these guidelines will be greatly appreciated. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My directions are concluded.
Thank you, Dr. Beers. Mrs. Cook?
Karen Baudette.
Hello there. My name is Karen Baudette. Today, I'd like to address the potential new school build and accessibility issues. My concerns are about accessibility and dignity, function versus aesthetics, reactionary versus proper planning, and basic common sense. I am a parent of a special needs, physically challenged student in the WJCC school district. Years ago, prior to Hornsby Middle School being built, I sent an email to the school board expressing concerns about any future builds and the need to plan ahead for student population changes so that our special needs students don't get landlocked to certain schools due to inadequate accessibility, such as classroom space design and bathroom personal care areas. A few board members responded that, of course, these concerns would be addressed. So Hornsby Middle School was then built, and surprise. That first year, the special needs students were placed on the second floor. In an emergency, we all know that one does not take an elevator. Apparently, those with mobility challenges were not considered on various levels on that classroom placement. The principal ended up having the ground floor home ec classroom gutted to accommodate the students for one of the special needs classes. This classroom also had the much needed attached large bathroom, which could accommodate an appropriate size changing station. I have experienced firsthand the lack of appropriate bathrooms and personal care areas within our school system for those students with special needs. For example, there have been tied together student desks with a mat in a teacher's bathroom, an army cot in the middle of a classroom with a portable privacy screen, toddler-sized facilities for older children, using unused teacher workspace during summer school, having contractors retrofit bathrooms at the 11th hour to accommodate incoming students, and the suggestion to just use the nurse's station. Those are just a few of the examples our family has had to address over the years. These are ADA health, safety, and dignity issues for the students and staff. Most people don't have to worry about where to use the bathroom or how to safely enter and exit buildings, but those with accessibility issues deal with this multiple times a day. As the new school is being considered in addition to any other future builds, my hope is that those that work directly with the students with physical disabilities, such as the special needs teachers and therapists, have input on how the new school is designed and how it affects them and their students daily. Their voice is strongly needed. By addressing this with you today, hopefully this will help prevent oversight that incoming families won't have to experience some of the same issues we've seen that could have easily been prevented. Please spend a day in a wheelchair before being concerned about aesthetics versus function. You may get a very different perspective of what is truly important. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Duda.
Jay Everson.
Jay Everson, 103 Branscombe Boulevard in the Berkeley District of James City County, now represented by Mrs. Young. Before I start up my subject, I just want to send the STAR program. My oldest son, when he first got into technology, got into the hardware side because you can't outsource it to India, as he used to say. It has to be done, you know, this kind of repair work has to be done on site. It can't be outsourced outside the United States. I put on my card about the block scheduling. I know that last year there was going to be a look at this scheduling issue at the high school. High School, and I think it has a number of reasons why it probably should be stopped, changed, modified, if you will. There are three reasons. The first is educational. If you miss time because you're sick, a couple, 3-4 days, you missed a week or two. If you come in the middle of the year, it's almost impossible to catch up. And if you take your advanced history, let's say in the fall, and you have your AP exam in May, for the, you know, to get college credit, not so good. Those are kind of the educational side. On the practical money side, I know that there's probably great concern and consternation among all of you and on the Board of Supervisors and City Council with the announcement that we're probably going to lose $2 million in funding from the Commonwealth this year. Well, it turns out that if you take block scheduling, you could reduce your teacher staff by about 20 to 75,000 total compensation. That's about $1.5 million a year. I can provide the information how that's calculated. Last year's your budget included 7 additional personnel for the high schools because of block scheduling. That would bring it up to about just over $2 million just by modifying block scheduling. But it also has some other one-third advantage in that when you have block scheduling in a 4x4 system, 25% of the rooms are empty at any one time to be in compliance with the teacher planning period. If you go to a six period day, you have, it increases your capacity of your school by 8%. If you go to 7, it increases it by 11%. And if you went to 7, you will notice that the increase in capacity of the 3 existing high schools would negate the need to have an expansion of $19 million starting in 21 and 22. And that's a pretty significant savings. I provided you detail on this, and so with that, I'll let you go. I appreciate your time.
Thank you, Mr. Everson.
Dave Jarman.
Good evening. My name is Dave Jarman. I live at 3646 South Square in the Berkeley District of James City County. I'd like to speak this evening briefly about 21st century education. Now, the fourth middle school, which is planned for the James Blair site, is being designed to accommodate key ingredients for a 21st century education. This approach is consistent with the foundational requirements defined in the Middle School Learning and Facility Study Committee report, which was prepared in May of 2013. The report states, the future learning needs of students should inform the decision on how to increase capacity at the middle school level and on the design of future school buildings. Yet, several key questions must be resolved in order to meet this goal. 1, what makes 21st century education different from what we have today? What defines 21st century education? 2, has input been gathered first from teachers, most importantly, then parents and community stakeholders on the curriculum specifics required to accomplish this new education paradigm? 3, after curriculum specifics are outlined, then and only then can one know what building design will best achieve these 21st century education requirements. Has this process been followed? 4, how do we train the teachers to operate in this new environment? What are the costs for this retraining? 5, how do we ensure equitable learning environments throughout the system? Do we upgrade other schools to replicate the environment plan for the new school? What are the capital costs to achieve this? Over what time period? It should be noted that the latest superintendent's 10-year capital improvement plan provides no funding for this. 6, where are examples nationwide of the successful design and implementation of such a plan? In 2014, in an article published in the Gazette, Dr. Constantino cited Gloucester County's Page Middle School and Virginia Beach's New Kellum High School as examples of individual schools in Virginia designed to accommodate these requirements. What has been the experience of these two new schools? Dr. Constantino, in the same article, emphasized that the decision to build new facilities for 21st century learning is one we will live with for 40 or 50 years. The operative question is, how can the school board ensure that this approach will be successful when essential steps highlighted by the questions outlined above have not been taken? Again, the operative question is, how can the school board ensure that this approach will be successful when the questions above have not been taken?
Thank you, Mr. Jarm.
Thank you very much.
Kim Hunley and Scott Bowser.
Good evening. We're with the Williamsburg Education Association. And first of all, we'd like to say thank you so much for letting us take part in the school board retreat. That was just very informational for us. And any input we can give you as you're going through the process, just let us know. We're also here, too, because we like to spotlight the silent students who have talents also in our school division. So Scott will tell you about your art, piece of artwork that you get to keep tonight.
Sixth grade has an advisory period. So throughout the year, you come tomorrow, my students will be working on listening skills. They've worked on organizational skills. We did a book study. We do different activities to go ahead and reinforce with the learning. So one of the things that we do is they made scribble posters to go ahead, you know, at least one day a week to give them something different, a chance to go ahead from some of the education that we're working on. So they made these, and what I told Ms. Hunley, I was going to use these for wrapping paper. And the students were like, wrapping paper? I said, yes, it's cheap, and I look at Pinterest just like everybody else. So we have some for you. You can use them as wrapping paper. There's many uses. Also, she likes color, so if you want to switch up, I have some here with some color with them. But hopefully it's something you can use in your office, or again, you can find another use for them.
And also, there's a lot of research with doodling, so while you all are working on the budget, it does open up brain cells. When you can actually doodle and listen as well as not doodling, so that's basically what, like, the scribble is. And also, we have some, thank you for sticking with the budget, and we have some of these for your cabinet members as well who've worked really hard on preparing those for you all. So these are for you. And that's from Toano.
Thank you. Appreciate it. A little gum, just what I need. That's all the speakers for this evening. That takes us to our consent agenda. 9.01, financial report, monthly bills and payroll, November 2015. 9.02, financial report, monthly bills and payroll, December 2015. 9.03, personnel actions. 9.04, request for use of facilities, Water's Edge Church at Lois Hornsby Middle School. Can I get a motion for approval of the consent agenda?
Mr. Chair, I move approval of the consent agenda, items 9.01, 9.02, 9.03, and 9.04.
Is there a second? It's been moved and seconded for approval of the consent agenda. Is there any discussion?
I have questions. Are we allowed to ask questions at this point?
We should have pulled the whatever you had questions off. We should have pulled that out of the consent agenda and moved it onto an action item. But which one did you have questions on?
Well, I noticed there's going to be a shortfall of funding because the state tax hasn't kept up with the projected budget, and I just would like somebody to answer how are we going to meet that shortfall.
Good evening. Each December, we forecast what our revenue is going to look like based on what we think our March 31st enrollment is going to be. So that is an estimation of losing several students. Typically, we are in an okay position even with the decline in that revenue based on other areas that are picking up. So we adjust midstream to lower our expenditures to match our revenue so that we do not overspend our budget.
How do you choose those items that are going to be adjusted?
That'll have to be a discussion as we continue to monitor the budget that we have with the superintendent to curb spending as we go throughout the year. But we continually monitor that and look at those projections as we go through each month.
Mm-hmm. Any other discussion? Ms. Erza, could you call the vote for the consent agenda as presented, please?
Mrs. Young.
Yes, aye.
Dr. Beers.
Yes.
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye. Brings us 10.01, VSB Code of Conduct for School Board Members. Can I have a motion for approval of the VSBA Code of Conduct for School Board Members?
Mr. Chair, I move approval of item 10.01, VSBA Code of Conduct for School Board Members.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? It's been moved and seconded for approval of the VSBA Code of Conduct for School Board Members. Ms. Serza, can you take the vote, please?
Ms. Hummel.
Aye.
Mrs. Young.
Aye.
Dr. Beers.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye. Brings us to 11.01, new middle school 35% design update. Dr. Constantino.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. The school board requires a 35% design presentation. You've had several presentations. We've tried to be as communicative as possible, and so we've had a lot of design presentations, development presentations. This really is the 35% mark, and our friends from Waller Todd and Fannie Howie are here to provide the board with this brief overview of the 35% design, answer any questions that you might have. Good evening, Michael.
Good evening, Howard. My name is Michael Hall. I'm an educational facility planner and architect with Fannie Howie Associates, and we're partnered with Waller Todd Sadler to produce this building for you. And we are at the 35% level of design, which normally is called design development, but that's where we are. And so we take a breath at that point and do some analysis of everything, cost, schedule, drawing, systems, budget, all those things have been on the table for the last week and will be for about another 2 weeks. Our basic schedule is special use permit was approved by the Planning Commission and City Council. I believe that was last week. We held a value engineering workshop starting a week ago Monday. That went from Monday till Friday evening. Your construction management selection will occur January, February, over the next month, month and a half. And then we will submit the site plan review for Planning Commission final approval March 16th. The design phase is broken into the two pieces of the project. There is an advanced piece, which is the demolition of the north section of the existing building and some of the site work and upgrade to the annex building to prepare it for district-wide administrative use. That design phase has already started and it will complete in February. We will bid that in March and construct that from May to August of this year so that that building is ready for continued operation as the district headquarters. The building itself, the design phase started back in August. It will complete about mid-May. We will bid it June and July and construct it from September till September of 2018, so that's or June of 2018. So I believe that's about a 20-month construction period, which we think is adequate for the size building we're talking about. That gives you the building in June so that teaching staff, administrators can move in, can learn about the technology, maintenance people can learn about the mechanical system, everybody can look at the furniture, and since most of it's gonna be mobile and on wheels, they can rearrange it at will. And so that's our basic schedule right now. Value engineering workshop generated 85 items by your VE consultant that they requested we look at. 48 of those will be evaluated for consideration. 20 of the most significant were presented during the workshop out briefing. When was that? A week ago, last Friday. And so we are looking at those as worthy of further consideration and scheduling meetings with the administration to talk about which of those we should take, which we shouldn't. That process will occur next week, over the first part of next week, and then we'll be in a position to bring the budget back together after we make those types of modifications. So the next step, the whole design team, the architects, mechanical engineer, electrical engineer, civil engineer, the plumbing, the structural, everybody's got the report. Everybody's looking at their section of it. It's a couple hundred pages, if I'm not mistaken. And once we get together with our team and decide what we want to recommend, then that will come to the superintendent and the design committee in the form of recommendations, and then we will bring that to the board in February for your review and acceptance. So that's where we're at tonight with the 35%. It's underway, it's hot and heavy. We're doing a lot with stepping back from the building at not 30,000 feet, but maybe 15,000 feet, and trying to look at what can we do to make it more efficient, what can we do to make it more simple to construct, what we can we do to make it more energy efficient, get more daylight into it, some of those type of things. So it's all underway. It's just we're right now, like I say, building the airplane while we're flying it, and looking at, I mean, it's from where the receptacles are to what type of roof are we're having. It's a total complete package, some plan changes, some curriculum related issues that we'll need to talk about. So that's all underway, and it's a very good process, by the way. The annex building, which we're going to modify so it can be kept in use, like I said, that will start in May. All the staff parking will be brought up to the front, and we will expand the lot where you enter off of Ironbound. There'll be a parking lot expansion there. From May to July, we'll do the reception area, which is upper right corner in yellow, with a conference room and some things we're doing in there. I'm sorry, it's the lower left corner is reception. We'll also be working on the utility switchovers up in the upper right corner so that the building can continue operating without affecting day-to-day use. And then we'll do a little bit of fire code things to the stair at the second floor in the upper left corner of the second floor plan. So we've talked to your folks about it. We've talked to your technology people. Everybody's on board. They understand it's a short run of a project. It's got to get done over the summer, and it's got to be operational by the time kids are ready to come back. So everybody's on board to get that done. So the basic review of where we're at, this is what we call the phase one site plan. And in this, in the lower right corner, the beige area is the part of the administration building and the annex that will remain. And then the new building fits up to the north of that in yellow. And you can see sort of how the bus loop and parking will all fall into place. And if you have some questions, we can come back to this. I have another diagram that kind of shows the traffic flow. And we have folks here that have been working on that since day one and can maybe answer your questions. Phase two are the brown pieces that are shown on the site plan to the right, which would be to the east, is the additional 300 student academic section. And towards the south is the new auditorium, music support spaces. Lower left corner is the fitness room, which was requested by the staff during the phys ed group on-site discussion that we had with them. So you see the softball field in the over to the left, and another field that's dotted in there that will spill over into the softball outfield so that we have joint ability to do things. And we're talking about, for softball, we'd have a removable fence, so you would just pull it out and let that other field splay into the outfield there. The current athletic field will not be touched. It's as is and will remain as is. This is an early rendering of the exterior, and that would be looking at the building from maybe the intersection of Ironbound and Long Hill. And we're still tweaking that, working with that, and some of the things that the value engineering process brought to light, we will look at those as to that may affect some of this. So like I said, it's a work in progress. And then the other thing we have is a sort of an aerial view of what this phase one piece looks like when it's finished. So you can see sort of the proximity of the new middle school on the right to the existing remaining pieces of the annex to the left. And we have 30-foot setbacks required by fire codes to keep the new building away from the old building. So as you can see, we've had to rotate and move some things to make sure that not only is the new building safe, but that other building can remain within the code and safe during its five-year expected life. So this just gives you kind of an aerial view of what the building's going to look like. And we're looking at some different materials, maybe around the top, and maybe some small manipulations to the media center, which is that white curving piece to the left. So you'll see more of this later as we move on down and we get time to evaluate the value engineering comments. So ready for Q&A on that?
Any board members have questions? Mrs. Hummel?
Assuming that there are ADA requirements that you are meeting,
I mean, it's the law. It's federal law.
Just in respect to the previous comment, are some of her concerns being addressed with
They're
this?
All being addressed. We okay. met as one of the design meetings that we had on site. We had the special ed leader in there with us to talk about what rooms needed to go where. Where is access? How does that access work? How is this? Are the spaces distributed throughout the building? How are the restrooms going to be equipped? Now, some of that's more detail than we're into yet, but that is detail that we have to do in every school building that we do. So we deal with that. We deal with the family restroom issue, transgender restroom issue. It's all out there. And as the architects, we have to be responsible and make sure it meets current codes and the current requests of the district. So absolutely. I wrote that note down just because there was a concern, but every bit of it will be addressed.
Mrs. Young?
My concern is also with that because how are special ed needs students who are on the second floor to get out of the building if there's a fire alarm or if they have to leave the building quickly?
We actually had that discussion during the value engineering process Friday, and we will have an emergency generator in the building, and that building will run the elevator. Some people don't do that in buildings. They create what's called an area of refuge in the stairs, and then there's a call box there, and the firemen have to come in, come up the stairs, pick the student up, and bring them down the stairs. We think it's a better solution to put the elevator on the emergency generator. So if the power goes out, there's a quick way to get everybody down out of the building.
Well, there's no long ramp or anything from the second floor to the first floor?
No. But not all the special ed is up on the second and third floor either. It's down around the administrative area. There's the more severely disabled room is on the first floor with its own bathroom. So we talked to the special ed director about all that.
Dr. Beers.
Was that one of the significant items that of the 20 that were presented during the workshop briefing?
With the generator?
I'm curious about what I know we're not going to take all night for that, but what were the significant items that were presented during the workshop? Because I've got no idea what those are, and I'm curious.
We haven't finalized them all yet. I have a list that some were saying yes, some were saying no. that will go to Alan Robertson and the district to look at, and Marcellus, some of his folks have to look at it. But I can tell you that one of the big ones is reducing the size of those hubs in the academic section down to the same square feet per student that we're using in some other buildings. Right now, they're nice, but they're liberal. And we think that we can squeeze that down and not affect the function of them. So that's one thing that we're looking at. We're looking at another type of mechanical system, which Marcellus's people need to look at. There's some savings there. There was a discussion about floor finishes that the estimator had priced terrazzo all over the building, and that was never the intent to begin with. So that's being limited to the first floor corridors and maybe some of the upper corridors, but everywhere else we'll probably go to either a carpet or a vinyl, which also has some sound reduction capabilities in it. We're looking
so, at. So after those 20 go to staff, you'll get together and decide which ones of the 20?
And we'll total them up and bring them back to the board.
Okay.
Right.
Mrs. Cook.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just following up on Dr. Beers, I wanted to confirm that at your next presentation to us, you will outline which value engineering items.
Absolutely.
Okay, excellent. Thank you.
Yes, you're welcome.
This is
Mrs. Holm.
So the cafeteria, the auditorium right now in phase one, where is the auditorium?
Where is it?
Yeah, in phase one.
You see the pale green spot right in the middle?
Okay.
So that's what we call it an auditoria because it's designed for dining, but it's also designed for theatrical performances.
So in phase two, is that when another, I thought I heard you say in phase two there was going to be an auditorium added?
To the bottom you'll see a black dashed line.
Oh, okay.
That's where the auditorium will go, and the reason that it would go there is so when there's intermission, people can come out of the auditorium, use the restrooms that are out there, congregate in the auditoria as kind of a common space, between performance space, and then come back into the auditorium. So
between phase one and phase two, there's going to be a lesser version of an auditorium, obviously.
Yes, and to the left, between the gym, which is blue, and the larger box of the pale green is a stage platform. So that there will be a stage that can be used in the auditoria before the auditorium shows up. And that stage currently will open either to the auditoria or it can open onto the gym. And then you could put like 750 folding chairs in there, or use some of the bleachers and the folding chairs for a larger gathering where you could get everybody together in the gym with a stage. So it flows both ways, and we think that's valuable. The other thing we've done is numerous cafeteria table layouts with our staff and with the kitchen consultant, so we know that we've got enough space in there to seat only in three seatings, the 600. And actually then, if we had to put kids, if the auditorium never happened, we could, and the building enrollment went up, we could get some tables up on that platform. So, you know, we're looking at it as a 900 student building, but maybe not all of it will happen, and then how do you deal with 900 kids? So we're trying to make it as flexible as possible. And I also know teaching staff, you know, once that platform's there, because the drama room is right across, it's a red rectangle right across from the auditoria. They'll be using that during the first phase, but my guess is they're also going to want to use that platform during phase two, because once teachers get used to something, so it's a very flexible environment. And the other thing is the buses unload up to the top of that drawing, and so we want a place where all the buses can unload and the kids can come in and be right there in the auditoria where there's plenty of space for them to hang out and congregate as the buses drop them off and come in.
Okay.
Has there been any talk of the students being able to have access to the existing auditorium in James Blair until phase two is?
No, because the building, the existing auditorium has to come down in order to make way for this building.
Okay. Oh, so that's the where the first demolition,
that's the problem,
and then
right.
Gotcha. Okay.
Like I said back in December, we are going to save some seats and some other things out of that existing auditorium and put them in the new middle school as a reference to the history of the site. So we're bringing some of the past into the future, into that new building, just to retain the history of it.
I just have one other point, really, to Mr. Jarman's comments that I guess that we do, all of us do our due diligence in trying to figure out this 21st century classroom environment and what is the best utilization of space in new schools.
Well, we visited a school that we did in Arizona, and it's probably the cutting edge 21st century building that I'm aware of. And it wasn't just to look at the building and look at the exteriors and the interiors, to look at how the building was used. And it was more, after 2 hours of touring the building, Dr. Constantino and Dr. Fruoff, who is the superintendent there, spent another 5 hours going back and forth over professional development and how do you bring teachers into an environment like that. And Dr. Fruoff is very, very knowledgeable about how to staff the new delivery of curriculum. So we didn't just go there to look at a building. It was more, how's the building get used and how do you adapt to it and how do you get teachers to use it the way it was designed. So I think there's a lot of things out there to help this district see what's happening and see what to do and what not to do.
A couple of questions. What changes are you making to the annex? There's some change talking about modifications to the annex.
We are in the lower left corner. We're adding on the upper drawing. We're adding a reception area and a conference room. So when people come in from the parking lot, they'll be met right there at the reception area and have access to a conference room.
That's what's currently the main building right now, right? The annex, I guess what I'm referring to.
Yeah, there's a difference of term usage.
In the other building?
In our meetings and our architects, we are looking at the existing James Blair as an annex to the new school. Mr. Kelly is referring to the back building, the building behind the main building that
one
we're keeping.
One to the west.
I'm sorry? The one floor.
In Blair and Cooley Field.
Yeah, we're not touching that building.
Okay. Okay, that clears that up for me. Utilities and infrastructure, I assume when we did our value engineering, that is still for the final configuration of the building after phase two is complete. All the water and the power and all that stuff will be sized to handle the final building configuration.
Everything's being sized as if we're going to put 900 kids there right away.
I share some of the concerns on the special ed, particularly the severely disabled. I appreciate that they are going to be on the first floor. I want to make sure that there's appropriate considerations for our special ed students that might not be on the first floor and how they get evacuated. I'm not sure about the elevators and the emergency power, but how that works. But I just think we need to have that discussion as we're going forward, because I don't know that we've had that discussion. I don't know that I'm quite satisfied with where we are right now with that. So I just want to make sure that we're pushing forward with that. You promised us a slide on drop-off paths and traffic. I saw it as you thumbed through it. So
this is phase one. Here's the site designer.
Okay. For on-site, we have, this shows the phase two, but it works very similar for both. For the red line, that is for the school operation. with the, nope, back one there. Okay, that'll work. For the red line, that shows how the school parents are coming in. They're all coming in off of Long Hill Road, and they will either turn either in left or right off Long Hill. They will come through the parking lot along the first bay of parking in it. Along that long drop-off in front, they'll park or stop temporarily along the front of the school along the sidewalk there. There's enough room there for about 15 cars. They can unload students or load students, whether it's pick-up or drop-off. When they leave that circle, they can head straight out to Ironbound Road and make a right out onto Ironbound if they're heading 2 points that direction. If they want to head back to Richmond Road, they come back through the site, through the parking lot, exit onto Long Hill Road with either a right turn or a left turn. If they're going to Richmond Road, they'll turn right, go up to the traffic light that's there at Ironbound and Long Hill. It'll be coming in before the school's done, turn left over towards Richmond Road, and then back onto Richmond Road from there. One of the keys with that is we wanted to make sure we had a path that didn't intersect within there, because as those cars are parked waiting to get to loading and unloading, we didn't want to have to cross them. For the bus drop-off, they have their own entrance that comes off the backside. This actually has one of the older views of the parking lot where we had them at an angle. We valued engineering some to
parent,
shorten it.
Go back to the parent drop-off real quick.
Parent drop-off, sure.
So the parent drop-off basically slaloms through the staff parking lot?
Yes, it goes through the staff parking lot up on the front side. Staff will come in before the students so that they're already parked in there. The parents come in, they will drop off, and then head back out through the parking lot and go. We didn't want to spend too much pavement that wasn't also used as a parking lot, because pavement's expensive and we wanted to minimize it. We are trying to watch our costs as well.
Right, so parents coming up Ironbound Road, coming from...
They will not be able to enter the site from Ironbound. They have to enter through Long Hill. There is a right in that's there, but that won't be available during pickup and drop-off.
Okay, so they come up, go through the intersection on Long Hill, come up and then come into the site in that direction. And so then they can... But they can exit back out onto Ironbound.
They can exit onto Ironbound, or they can exit onto Long Hill.
Can they exit Ironbound either direction?
Hmm?
Can they exit Ironbound either direction?
No, they can only turn right out onto Ironbound. Okay. You can't turn left. The city would like us to put a concrete median in front of that to prevent the left turn. The left turn movements take longer than the right turns, and it'll back up onto the site.
Sure.
And it's too close to the intersection for access management for left turn access.
Okay, so the parking lot where I see the blue, which is the administration parking,
yes.
Is there a connection from there to the parking lot that goes towards the red lines?
Phase one, there is not, because the current central admin office building is there. So they are going to come in and out for the central admin office through the existing entrance. We're going to upgrade that entrance to a standard current commercial entrance there, as opposed to the entrance that's there now.
Okay, so that parking lot that I'm seeing there is in the final
phase.
That's
in phase
two. First phase.
Correct. In phase two, when we add the auditorium, and the extra 300 students, we need a little bit more parking, so we put a parking lot that connects the two as part of phase two.
After the building. And I presume that we'll have an updated budget after we get through all the value engineering and come up with an updated construction cost of where we are. All right, I think I'm good.
We have our traffic expert on the intersection improvement out there. If anybody's got any questions about that?
I think I'm...
More questions?
Nope, we're good, thank you.
We'll be back in February.
Not very far from now.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Welcome to the design team, the new folks.
Yeah, we do. There obviously several board members are interested in, as you takeaways, our special ed and how we're managing the special ed, and what is being value engineered and the consequences of those. So those are of all the things. I think those two things are the most important takeaways.
I will go back to the special ed director and walk through this one more time. Or two more times, whatever it takes, just to make sure that we heard. We heard and we changed and we sent it back up for them to look at, and there weren't any comments. But, you know, I'd like to assure you that we've been through it again. So.
Yeah, I would also like to just get middle school special ed teachers engaged in that discussion, and particularly I think Hornsby, since that with the three stories kind of mimics that. So make sure that those teachers are comfortable with our our special ed student evacuation plan for how that building would be configured.
Yeah, no problem.
That works.
Thank you.
Brings us 11.02, annual review of 2015 SOL performance. Dr. Constantino.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. Each year we provide an overview of the standards of learning assessments from the previous year, and Mr. Thorpe is here to take you through a couple of documents and a presentation on that data. Mr. Thorpe.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Dr. Constantino. We're going to review our standards of learning assessment results and outcomes for the 2015 school year. And at your seat, you have two infographics to which we'll refer in just a bit. Our continued focus and reporting of student performance and achievement aligns with the WJCC strategic plan, Priority 1, High Student Achievement for 21st Century Success. And we're always happy to have an opportunity to mention that our school division is fully accredited. And then now looking at our infographics, we've got two infographics. The one with the green band across the top, that compares WJCC's SOL pass rate performance with like school divisions. And I'd like to take an opportunity to talk to you a little bit about benchmarking. And benchmarking is the practice of comparing key metrics of our operation to other similar groups. And in the Commonwealth of Virginia, as a result of similar student enrollment, budget, and demographics, we've identified Augusta County, Rockingham County, Frederick County, Fauquier County, and Bedford County as five of our like school divisions. And when we take a look at our infographic for reading and writing and math and social studies and science, with the exception of Rockingham County scores in math and social studies, which were higher than ours, we outpaced all of our like school divisions. We also compare with our neighboring Region 2 friends in York County, Newport News, Hampton, and Pocosin. And I want to direct your attention to the top of that infographic. And I'd like you to take a look at the differences between our school division and these school divisions in student enrollment and budget, students with disabilities, limited English proficiency. So our comparison with these Region 2 schools is largely geographic in nature. Still, we take a look at their performance versus ours. In the Commonwealth of Virginia, here are the performance targets that are used to determine accreditation. So again, just as an example, a school or division would need pass rates of at least 75% in order to be accredited in the area of reading. Now, in addition to monitoring performance of all students, as well as we follow ethnic groups, as well as students with disabilities, limited English proficiency, and economically disadvantaged, along with these three proficiency gap groups. And gap group one, students with disabilities, limited English proficient students, and economically disadvantaged students. And a student can only count once in gap group one, even if they are more than one of those, in one of those categories. Gap group two, these are African American students, and gap group three, Hispanic. For the next few slides, we're going to share SOL pass rates across a three-year trend by subgroup.
Can you go back one slide real quick? Are those self-identified categories? African-American students, Hispanic students?
That's right. Okay. Yes, sir. So for English reading, we see that performance has either increased or stayed the same in 8 out of 9 subgroups from the 2013 school year to the 2014-15 school year. And we could actually say the same for writing. 8 out of 9 subgroups We either stayed the same or increased with the exception of our Asian subgroup. In math, from 13-14 to 14-15, we see that student pass rates stayed the same or increased with the exception of slight decrease from 96 to 95% with our Asian subgroup. Trend performance is steady or improving in 8 out of 9 subgroups with our history and social sciences. And in science, these same patterns of steady performance or growth are holding true. So in these next two slides, what we'd like to do for both reading and math is put a spotlight on a couple of subgroups in particular, and that's our limited English proficient subgroup, along with African American and economically disadvantaged. And you can see with reading that there is steady growth with our African American and economically disadvantaged groups from 13-14 to 14-15 with a bigger leap in performance from in that two-year trend with our limited English proficient. We really can say those same words for our math trends as well over these 2 years. Again, steady growth, African American and economically disadvantaged, and bigger gain with our limited English proficient group. We're now going to spotlight our students with disabilities, and again, we take a look at all of the 5 assessed areas over a 3-year trend, and while our division's pass rates are the same or better than all of our like school divisions with students with disabilities, the performance of our students with disabilities remains an opportunity for improvement. Again, taking a look at the performance of our limited English proficient subgroup over 3-year trend and across the 5 assessed areas, we can see that there is either steady or more dramatic growth across 3- and 2-year trends. So just a couple of talking points, our keys to success. We're continuing to use evidence-based interventions used to support our students who are struggling. Our WJCC, Individual School Improvement Plans, they are aligned with our division's strategic plan. And as a real shout out to teachers, they're continuing to do an amazing job, not only planning for rich and creative learning, but they're also on a daily basis, a regular basis, checking for student understanding and then acting quickly on any assessed areas of need for student improvement. Continuing on, we're using research-based programs to provide more intensive support, again, to those students who are still working toward grade-level proficiency. Our school leaders are working to provide coaching support for teachers to better improve their practice. And we are continuing to offer increased levels of feedback to teachers about the student engagement and learning that's being observed in the classroom. And what we're continuing to do, offer specific resources and strategies for students who are learning English. Sorry, I went one too far there. Specific resources and strategies for students learning English. We've got, each school has some or multiple methods of having data that helps their team or department make decisions about individual student performance and next steps with learning. And then also our teams and departments are working so tightly together for planning for, as we said earlier, rich and creative learning opportunities. There's our update on SOL performance from this past school year. Do you have any questions?
Thank you for this update. There's a tremendous amount of information here. I can't wait to spend some time with it and study. But I'm curious if you happen to know whether any of the schools, whether Region 2 or the like school divisions, how many of those are fully accredited like WJCC? Do you happen to know that?
I don't happen to know that. That's a great question. We'll get that information to you.
It's we're a minority in this in the state at being fully accredited. It's something that I'd like to know. Also, thank you for adding the operating budget to this document. That's very helpful. I appreciate that very much. And the limited English proficient SOL pass rate, the trend there, the increase, congratulations on that to everybody. That's really great. And if I understand correctly, not only has the percentage of the limited English proficient population in our school division gone up, obviously so has the raw number because our population is growing. So I just, that congratulations, I'd like to know a little bit more about that because it's pretty dramatic and impressive with growing numbers and increased pass rates at the same time.
Indeed, I know our teachers of ESL as well as our classroom teachers, they've worked very hard to make certain that students are not only having an opportunity to learn and use their social language with family, with friends, but also the academic language. Those are those terms and vocabulary that's related to the standards being taught and assessed. So, yeah, that's one of our keys to success there.
Dr. Beers?
Yes, I recognize and I applaud the overall growth in academic achievement across the district. But Ms. Thorpe, I've also raised the question before, and you probably know the question I'm going to ask again, is one of the things that I have noticed when I look at all the data is I notice gaps in the elementary schools, and regardless of the school, just if you just took all the elementary kids. And I notice achievement gaps with those between several of the gap groups and white students. I noticed that as we go up through the grades, up to fifth grade, the gaps get smaller and smaller, which is really positive. But then we hit the middle schools, and the gaps really grow again. They're quite large, you know, like 23, 30, 30 point difference, that sort of thing. And by the 11th or 12th grade, they're still gaps. They're not quite as great. I am concerned about how we are addressing or how we're dealing or if we're even recognizing those gaps in the middle school. A couple of questions I have. I would like to know if staff in the elementary schools are interacting and working with staff at the middle schools so that it's very clear what the expectations are. And what can be done so that we don't lose what's been occurring in the elementary grades once they get to the middle school.
Great question, and thank you so much. We actually are aware of those gaps, and that, again, is a real opportunity for improvement with us. I can speak to this point. I know that transition meetings occur when students articulate from grade 5 to grade 6, and I know that those are very key meetings during which individual student opportunities for growth are, as well as their preferred learning styles, are discussed. I can't speak
and
anymore
I,
about...
You know, I really focus, is sort of my want to do. I very much focused on reading and writing and some of the math, but it was primarily the English that I was really looking at, and so I'm concerned about those gaps.
We are as well, and we'll, as we continue to try new things and improve on what we're already doing, we'd be happy to share that with you. Thank you.
Alma?
I just wanted to say, I know sometimes and it's necessary for us to talk about the gaps and talk about the negatives, but these reports are very, very positive overall, and I think the school district should feel really, really proud of the great strides that we've made. So I just want to say kudos to WJCC for keeping the bar high and keep, you know, you're doing great. So
yep, we're trying
to
thank
throw
you.
That out.
One of these things that these infographics, it's one of those things that you keep looking at and you find more information that's kind of amazing to you. And as you continue to digest them, when you look at like school division performance, for instance, where I think the like is primarily on the curriculum, on the number of students enrollment versus economically disadvantaged, disabilities, that kind of thing. So with like school systems around the Commonwealth, where we have similar enrollments, we're still not similar because our students with disabilities population is very near the top on that, limited English proficiency, we're kind of in the middle on that. One of the things which I just find interesting too is the number of schools, R15 and soon to be 16, is still lower than any other school division that of like, which tells you that they have smaller schools and probably better ratios. The other thing, when I look at the Region 2, which this is a new infographic for us, we haven't had this one in the past, I don't believe. I find it interesting, limited English proficiency, for instance, WJCC has the same percentage as Newport News, which I don't know that I would have expected that. And we are at the top. A lot of people try to compare us to York. York has about 1,400 more students than we have, but they're significantly reduced in limited English proficiency and as well as students with disabilities. So I find that interesting. The other thing too is that as Mrs. Hummel said, that, you know, these are good results. I mean, we're at the state, we're at the, you know, in the region, and we compare very, very favorably to every measure that you have. I think the teachers will be the first to tell you that we're not done, and we're not going to congratulate ourselves too much on this because there is still work to be done. When they're all not 100%, when you have those achievement gaps that Dr. Beers talked about, that the teachers and the administration all understand that, but our results don't happen by accident. The administration, the curriculum developers out there developing what we're going to serve our students with, the teachers working together collaboratively, what strategy worked for you, what strategy worked for me. I think that's all great stuff. Some of the professional development we've done. At the end of the day, these results are not the school board's results. They're not the administration's results or anybody at James Blair. They're the teacher in the classroom's results. And the good, hard work that they do on a daily basis to serve the individuals, which aggregates up to the entire school division. So, you know, we need to make sure that our teachers understand, that we understand that it's them. It's those are the guys who run the classroom and in the trenches. Doing the hard work. So I just want to put my appreciation and thanks out to those teachers in the classroom, K through 12 and everywhere, that I appreciate the good work that they're doing and the results that we're getting. So thank you. So that brings us to 12.01, Program of Studies, 2016-2018. Dr. Constantino.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. Tonight we're asking to place a proposed agenda item. We're at that time of year where we need to share with you the updates in the programs of studies, and we'll need your approval in upcoming meetings so that those may be published and we can begin the process of course selection and curriculum for next year. And so I know that you have a document. Why don't I just be quiet? Let Ms. Parker tell you what document you have. It'd be a lot easier. Go ahead.
Okay. Thanks. Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the school board, and Dr. Constantino. This is the proposed program of studies for 2016-2018, which is really an academic and career planning guide for our middle and high school. And our proposed program of studies does align with our strategic plan in priority one, which is high student achievement for 21st century success, goal two, in priority two, which is safe, secure, and welcoming climate for learning, goal four, as well as priority four, which is trust and authentic partnerships with family and broader community, goal nine. So some overall changes and updates to the proposed program of studies. The table of contents was reorganized to provide a quick reference and increase the ease of use. The middle and high school information is now housed in the same document in order for cohesive and continuous academic planning. The document will be available online as a PDF that can be easily navigated using the linked table of contents from any computer or mobile device. And a small number of hard copies will be printed and provided to each middle and high school to ensure equity among students in the academic and career planning process. Some additional overall changes and updates. We have added a section instructing how to use the program of studies for academic and career planning purposes to the beginning of the program of studies. This includes an introduction to the 16 career clusters and links each career cluster to the Virginia Department of Education website, which goes into great detail about clusters and pathways and occupations. This section also includes information and a direct link to Virginia Education Wizard, which is our state-supported website for academic and career planning. And it also includes a sample of our academic and career plan. We have also revised the academic and career plan and course selection registration information to include some updated language. In the middle school program, we have updated the upper elementary and middle school math sequence to reflect the updated eighth grade math pathway. And in the high school program, we have updated diploma types to align with the Virginia Department of Ed. Specifically, we removed the Virginia Modified Standard Diploma information as it will no longer be an option for students. The term Applied Studies Diploma has replaced the term Special Diploma to reflect the change in term from the Virginia Department of Ed. The term General Achievement Adult High School Diploma has replaced the term General Achievement Diploma, again to reflect a change in term with the Virginia Department of Education. And we added the State Board of Education's Biliteracy Seal as a graduation recognition seal per the Virginia Department of Education. We have also updated weighted courses to include 6 AP courses offered by our division in Virtual Virginia. And we've updated current courses offered by Virtual Virginia to reflect 9 additional course offerings for the upcoming year. In our special program section, the Greater Peninsula Governor STEM Academy replaced the Governor's Academy for Innovation, Technology, and Engineering to reflect a program and title change through our Governor's Office and the Virginia Department of Ed. We have added a description of Project Lead the Way. And we have updated the list of course offerings for New Horizons Career and Technical Education Center to reflect New Horizons updates. And we have also revised the New Horizons Governor School of Science and Technology section to highlight key information, to include a list of all updated course offerings, and to differentiate between the admissions procedure and the pre-admission series. And this is an overview of all updates made to our course offerings in middle and high school. You have in front of you a detailed summary of each of these updates made. Specific to middle school, updated course descriptions in fine arts, health and PE, math, world language, and CTE. And specific to high school, there were updated course offerings in English, history, and world language. Some updated course offerings in regards to our CTE program. We included revised work-based learning guidelines from the Virginia Department of Ed Office of CTE. We revised Project Lead the Way section to include all of the new course offerings for the upcoming academic year. And we updated course titles to reflect Virginia Department of Education updates in course titles. Specifically, we updated Nutrition and Wellness, Independent Living, and now Software Engineering. Some of the proposed courses to be removed are listed here, as well as the different enrollment trends for the past 3 years for each of the courses. We are proposing to remove English 9, reading and writing. You can see the enrollment has been low to none over the past 3 years. Honors English 11 and AP US History will now be offered as 2 standalone courses. AP English 12 and Humanities Enhanced are also going to be offered as 2 standalone courses. And Office Specialist 1, 2, 3, as well as Office Administration, are proposed to be removed, as the skills and abilities and knowledge that are acquired in those courses are now integrated throughout the entire curriculum of business information and technology education. And medical terminology is proposed to be removed as well due to difficulty in staffing that course. Just a few upcoming dates quickly approaching in regards to our course request timeline. February 1st really kickstarts when middle and high school counselors start conducting individual student planning sessions. The week of February 15th is when we start having our middle and high school evening parent information sessions and curriculum fairs. And February 22nd is when our course request window opens for all rising 6th through 12th grade students. And those are the proposed changes to our program of studies. And I'm happy to answer any questions at this time.
Mrs. Young.
Yes, ma'am.
I noticed that in this, I've read the document and seems like you've put a lot of effort into it. I do have a question about JROTC.
Okay.
I noticed that it's not included for high school students. And yesterday, when I was at the Martin Luther King breakfast, there was one student who was already planning to pursue ROTC in university at the university level. Why isn't it included? We live in a community that's highly, heavily influenced by the military and our surrounding. We talk about equity with our corresponding units around us, York, Newport News, Hampton. They have our junior ROTC. Is there a reason that we haven't pursued that? And if not, then I would like very much to find out what the cost of including this program at our high school level would be at each of the high schools. Because I personally know of several students that are planning on entering the military and would be very interested in finding out that information.
Absolutely. I can definitely get that information to you.
Well, the way that has worked in the past is that we have asked for those ROTC programs, and the branches of the military have actually reduced their junior ROTC programs due to funding constraints that they have. So it's not our lack of interest. It's on the military's lack of being able to provide the program.
Okay, so if there's reduced funding, from what I have understood, is that in some cases we have to provide funding? Is that what I'm hearing?
You have to provide funding anyway, but the military won't provide the staffing.
Okay, because I would like to pursue that.
We have, and board members in previous years, Mrs. Young, have asked the very same question. We would bring a recommendation to start an ROTC program tomorrow. The military won't extend its program any further. We've asked repeatedly and have in writing that we simply, and there's a long waiting list in the Commonwealth for ROTC programs. Should we ever get a program, it is a shared funding where it's about a 50-50 split between the military and the school division. School division picks up all of the materials costs and all of the various and sundry other costs that we would with any other class. So it's not something that we've ignored, and it's not something that we wouldn't like to pursue in the future. And should the military, I suspect the military has undergone the same budget constraints that we all have gone through the recession. And so their expansion of the JROTC program has just either been significantly reduced or in some cases halted. Should that change, we'd be very interested in that.
Absolutely. Very interested in revisiting that if that changes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Dr. Beers.
I have a couple of comments. One thing I want to make sure that I understood. The proposed changes, I'm looking at that first draft, and I'm assuming the things that were crossed out, or that's a reflection of the proposed changes.
Absolutely.
So whatever remains untouched.
Yes.
Okay, because I have some questions about some of the untouched.
Okay, great.
One of them was on page 4. Let me know what the length of the ad drop time is, you know, how many weeks, how many days, what is that?
For ad drop, we do twice a year, and it can extend from 1 to 2 weeks.
That's one, because I noticed it wasn't in there, and when I was at William & Mary, that was always a critical
yes.
date, so you knew... when you get screaming students in the middle of the night. I've got another question on, I think this is page 19, WJC eligibility for middle school athletes. I'm looking under academic requirements, third paragraph down. A student has a total of 2 years of eligibility. Athletic eligibility and ineligibility is determined 2 days after grades are turned in. So after the grades have been turned in at the end of a semester, a student couldn't suddenly register for a course right after that.
After the grades have been turned in.
It could be an independent study, it could be, and that wouldn't count. It has to be if you haven't completed your courses by the end of that grading period, then that's the rule, correct?
Of course, we need to be completed.
Right. I just want to make sure I understand that.
Yes, sir.
Let's see, I guess that was page 11, the phrase, who are ready? This course is designed for advanced art students who are ready. I just like having, you know, I have a granddaughter who's a phenomenal artist, and I'm just curious how that is determined. How is it determined that somebody's ready or not?
If someone's ready or not. By the time students want to take that course, a lot of times they have a lot of collaboration with the art teacher, and together they look at portfolios and previous work samples, and they determine whether or not the student feels ready to move on.
I know you pulled the folios information out
of
there. That's why I was curious.
Those will still be happening. However, they will no longer replace the Foundations of Art course. And really, that's due to the seat time being about 60% less than the Foundations of Art course. And so that's why we're no longer going to allow that to replace that. But they can still absolutely take Advanced Art 8.
Right. So mm-hmm. It actually increases the possibility of more students signing up for something like that. Good. Where do students learn software language? I looked in the technology program of studies, and I kept looking for that. You know, this is where you learn Java, this is where you learn whatever it might be. Where's that take place?
In some of our computer science courses, a lot of the programming is addressed there. We actually have our CTE. I'm not quite sure exactly what specific classes in regards to curriculum incorporate that into their curriculum. We do have our CTE coordinator, Helen Manns, here. She might be able to speak to
that. I know it's really, it's critical in, at the high school level.
Absolutely.
But personally, I'd also love to see that going on in the elementary grades as well.
Yes,
I concur.
I think it's really, because it's the language. And in some places, they actually, computer language substitutes is almost treated as if it was a foreign language. And I completely agree
at elementary as well as middle. I know we participate, multiple schools of ours participate in the hour of coding as well to start exposing students to that exact language. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Mrs. Cook.
Thank you. Go ahead. So last year, I believe you reformatted this and put it online in a different way.
Yes.
Have you gotten any feedback on that? How's that gone?
We did. Because last year was not a complete revision to the program of studies. It was just some amendments to the existing program of studies because we do revise it every 2 years. There were fewer changes that needed to be made that went online. And we've really compared a lot to what our other region counterparts do, as well as access to the program of studies. And so that's why we recommended that we go back to a PDF format that's available online, printable, easy to download. And we will also continue to push that out through our view system as well.
The introduction to technology in middle school, just want to confirm that's in addition to it's not taking away anything.
Absolutely.
And
nope.
Okay, have you seen it have, in the pilot stage, any impact on enrollment in other electives?
No, it was a much needed addition course to offer more opportunities for students, and it is very well attended and enrolled. We have, I believe it's an average of about 58 students per semester per school. Who have been taking the pilot of Introduction to Technology. And so because of those large enrollment numbers, when it came to the end of its pilot this year, we decided to include that.
And then I saw that the Honors English 11 Advanced Placement U.S. History as a joint has had no enrollment recently. I realize that perception and reality don't always you know, match, but my perception has always been that that's an incredibly popular combination, and historically has been. So I'm just curious if you have a sense of why that's changed in the more recent history.
I do not. I know that for the past 2 years, that is when that course was offered kind of as the combination, but the course is also offered as a standalone course, and that enrollment for the standalone courses have continued to be very high. But I can definitely look into that.
I'd be curious what was driving that, yeah.
Ms. Hummel?
Excellent. Dr. Nunnally is here as well, who can answer that question for you.
Excellent.
Good evening. The purpose for that is because if students were actually, and I'm Kimberly Nunnally, secondary English. I apologize. The purpose is because if a student wanted to drop the course, they would have to actually drop both courses. So it didn't afford them the opportunity to take them in isolation. They actually had to take them together. So it did not afford our students that opportunity. And so we wanted to be able to provide that to the students. So even though there was an increase, but we also heard voices from parents and also from students that if they wanted to drop one, they had to drop both. So we wanted to offer them standalone.
The course is still integrated at least?
Yes,
okay.
There are. And there are conversations that happen with our social sciences teachers as well. So, yes.
Okay.
Ms. Hummel.
Well, on the same subject, so just so I'm clear, because when my kids, all three of them, took A Push and they loved it at Lafayette, I mean, it was just like one of the great things about, you know, just being able to tie the two together. And it was also great because they would go A day and B day and flip-flop back and forth, and so they'd have time to work on projects or digest information and report back to it a couple days later. Am I understanding that there will be no more AB, it's going to be just one block of AP? Okay. I'm not sure if I like that, but whatever. I just
students like it.
Huh?
The students like it.
Okay.
They do.
Yeah, because it was also, because it said it was not popular, because it was really popular at Lafayette. So I'm not sure, was it not popular across the board? Or, I mean, was Lafayette just an anomaly and it was just really popular?
No, it was across all three schools, absolutely.
And I can go back, I'm sorry, I can go back and revisit enrollment numbers prior to the past 3 years, if you'd like. I think that would be to see, because we have the enrollment numbers for the past 2 years, but if we'd like to kind of look and revisit before that, I'd be glad to do that. Yeah.
Thank you. And then
sure.
I just had a couple questions. I did want to kind of reiterate what Dr. Beer said, in that anything that we can do to increase computer literacy.
Yes.
Reap huge benefits as far as workforce development.
Absolutely.
Preparation for college. One of the things that at William & Mary are entering freshmen, it's digital literacy. And if they do not have digital literacy, and that's understanding how to use Word, PowerPoint, Excel, it's one of the core things that all of our students graduating with a degree just should be competent in those areas, because they're expected to know it.
Right.
And to actually have to have a class to teach Excel at a college level is going away. So I just want to make sure our students aren't at a disadvantage to other students in the Commonwealth, and that we're making sure we're teaching those basics.
Absolutely. Those skills are integrated throughout the curriculum of most of our technology education courses, as well as our business information courses. And then at the middle school level, we do have technology courses geared, introduction to technology, and courses geared specifically for that. So we are integrating that throughout, instead of just focusing on it in isolation, really integrating that through all of our subject content, because I'm assuming it's probably the same on the college level as well. It's not taught in isolation. It's more integrated throughout all of the subject areas. Yep. That's an excellent point.
I share Mrs. Hummel's concern about A Push, because I know that's pretty popular at Jamestown. So I'm concerned that that's going away. You need to understand that.
Sure.
And why that is. I noticed in your presentation, the medical terminology course, you had pretty good staffing, but or a pretty good enrollment, but you said you had a staffing problem?
We did. Division-wide enrollment wasn't very high, but it's a very difficult course to staff.
What would be the requirements for the staff?
I don't know the exact endorsements, but I can certainly find that out for you.
Is that something that could be offered as an online course for students?
Medical terminology mm-hmm. course? Mm-hmm. We can look into different online providers. Again, it would still be the staffing issue if it was offered through our virtual learning program. And so, did you?
I can speak toward the sure. staffing. We've had a series of teachers come stay with us for a short amount of time and leave. It's very, very hard to find somebody that will teach a part-time that's not a full section, not a full load of that particular course. So we have not been able to maintain staffing consistently. So rather than do a search every year for somebody to come and teach 3/6 of the schedule, we're finding that we can look into the option for computer-based.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you. Any other board member comments? Well done. Thank you.
Thank you. And again, I know it's a large document. If at any point you're continuing to review it and have additional questions, please feel free to send them our way.
Thank you very much. That brings us 13.01, board member comments. Any board members have any comments? Mrs. Young?
Okay, several. First of all, we have been appointed to committees, and what are the committees that report to the board specifically?
All the committees are board committees.
Such as?
Special education, 21st century, the policy committee, all those are committees of the board.
Okay, so how are they reported back to the board? So once we meet, for example, if Kyra and I are on the policy committee, and how do we inform the rest of the board? Do we do it here at this meeting?
You have a process in your policy manual, Mrs. Young, that outlines that the committees that you establish in CTE, special education, and the student committee, you'll accept a report every spring from those committees. Your policy committee can update the regular board at your will.
Okay, I'm just wondering because I was reading the SOPs today and I'm unclear about how information is relayed back to the board.
Right. I would recommend you go back to the policy and to the policies of the committees. And I think the SOP has a lot of information, doesn't have all the information, but the policy will share with you that each spring the committees are invited to submit a report to the school board based on their year's activities. Actually required. Is that not invited? Required.
Okay. My other question is, today Mr. Everson brought forth his research on the block scheduling and how that would reduce the need for the new middle school. And I have a question about, at one point I had understood from what was reported here at the board that there was a committee that was looking at the different types of scheduling. Did I understand that correctly?
There's presently an ongoing committee looking at high school scheduling. That's correct.
Okay, so if the committee determines that block scheduling or a form of block scheduling isn't the best for the community, and there are some reasons why block scheduling is not positive for this community, how would that impact the new building if it's not needed?
The committee is looking at high school scheduling because the conversation is about high school scheduling and the block scheduling at the high schools. And so
right, but
the relationship between this committee and the middle, there is no relationship at the moment between this committee and the middle school. This is a high school. The concerns brought forward by the previous board were about high school block scheduling.
Okay. So how is it scheduled for a middle school, since I'm not a middle school teacher?
It's a variation of the block, but it's middle school scheduling is very different from the high school.
And then the other thing was that I noticed that in the Y Daily it reported that there were 4 lawsuits at one of our schools. Are there 4 lawsuits, and if so, are there others that are pending before the board and the superintendent's office?
That's not something we talk about in open session.
Okay, so I can ask about that in closed session?
Correct.
Okay, I'll be glad to do that. Thank you.
Ms. Cook?
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just wanted to note that I think it was 2 weeks ago the PTA Council had their reflection ceremony and several board members attended. So that was a lovely event, and it was covered in the local media. And congratulations to all the winners and the talented students that we have. And yesterday, the NAACP hosted their annual AXO breakfast, and I believe we were all there, and that was a lovely event. A lot of incredible students, about which we should be proud, doing some great academic work. And I also wanted to note that on the 25th of this month, PTA Council will be having their meeting. I don't know what building, but it'll be at 7 o'clock, and so you can find that online. Anyway, thank you, Mr. Chair.
Dr. Beers?
I've got several things. As the new WJCC school board member, the Special Education Advisory Committee, I'd like the board to, and it's at your discretion, we'd like to try to get more parents appointed to that board. And I know that the deadline, the fall deadline is, we're way past that for the board to appoint, but I know in the committee policy statement, it states at the discretion of the board can appoint members to a committee, to a board committee, even after the fall deadline. And I would like the board to exercise that discretion so that I can make an announcement that we very much would like parents and interested in citizens, educators, to consider becoming members of that committee.
Yeah, I do believe you quote the policy correct. I have to go back and verify that because I haven't checked the language, but I believe that is our discretion. And we would certainly be willing to consider applicants for that to staff those committees.
Do I need to make a motion for that, or we just...
No, we wait till we get interest, letters
okay,
of interest.
Okay, so, well, then I can go on with the rest of what I was going to say relative to that. As the new WJCC school board member of the Special Education Advisory Committee, SEAC, I joined Christine Tyrone, SEAC chair, to invite parents and interested citizens and educators to submit an application to become a member of this important board committee. Our first meeting this semester is this Thursday, January 21 at 6:30 at the JCC Rec Center. We very much need your support. We need your commitment to the education of our students with special needs. So please consider this important opportunity to serve these students. For more information, you can go to the Citizen Advisory Committee at the WJCC school website. And I encourage people to really consider that. I've got one more thing. I'd like to echo what Mrs. Cook said about those two remarkable events, the Martin Luther King breakfast celebration and that extraordinary, and I must tell you, I have not been on a school bus. Oh, I can't even remember. And the first thing I noticed when I got on the school bus, there wasn't a rusty iron bar across the top of it. So I felt really safe riding around in that as we went to those schools to make those awards to those incredible teachers. I also attended the fall academic award ceremony at Lafayette High School last week, and I was also very much impressed, not just for the athletic performance of so many teams, but also the dedication and commitment of students, parents, teachers, administrators, and coaches. But the recognition of what is best in a genuine athlete, a genuine student athlete, athletic and academic excellence. I shouldn't have been floored because of all the work that goes on out at that school, but I was absolutely amazed at the number of athletes who had outstanding GPAs. And all I could think of was these really are student athletes. They're the best that there are. So my hat goes off to Dan Barner, the athletic director, all his coaches for an outstanding fall, and I look forward to following the Rams in the upcoming months. Thanks.
Ram pride.
Except, of course, when they're playing the Eagles and the Lions, right?
Yeah.
Having gone to several of those in my lifetime, you'll find that at all the high schools.
I know. That was my first one. I can't wait to go to the others.
The grade point averages and the academic Absolutely. Achievement of those athletes beyond the athletic field, and then just how the successes they have on the athletic field as well. It seems like 2 weeks ago we got started. Oh, wait, it was 2 weeks ago we got started, and there's been a lot on our plate since, and there's a lot still coming up. It was already mentioned the PTA reflection ceremony and how good that was. The foundation, it had been a long time since I'd been on a school bus, and that was not like any school bus I remembered. Much more comfortable than the ones I seem to have beaten to a football game, too. So this past Saturday was our budget retreat. I appreciate all the active participation of the board members and all the efforts that went into the preparation of the retreat, from Dr. Constantino and Dr. Heron to Mrs. Berta and her staff, as well as all of the rest of the administration, the support staff. I really appreciate the good work that you did to provide us with things to think about, and I hope we did some good work for you going back to the administration with guidance on what we're collectively thinking. I want to thank all the board and Dr. Constantino for attending the AXO Award breakfast yesterday, the NAACP. You know, it was said earlier that you don't hear about students helping the community. Well, we certainly heard about that yesterday. It was great to see all of the area students that were recognized, as well as, and particularly our WJCC students, and the successes, and it's really kind of humbling when you go and you see what these kids are doing and how busy they are. So as was mentioned earlier, you know, we're getting into it. We're getting into our school boards and our boards and our committees. You know, as board members, when you participate on a committee, whether it's New Horizons, WHRO, SEAC, or whatever, just want to remind that you're representing the board and not yourself. So when you go to those meetings, they look at you as a school board, and so you have to be, you know, the opinions you express are the opinions from the board. So just kind of keep that in mind. Sometimes you have to refrain from making promises or expressing opinions, because those you are speaking for on behalf of the entire board. So just be a little bit cognizant of that as we're out there doing that. On the HRO board, the New Horizons board, and coming back to what Mrs. Young was saying, you know, 40 minutes of meetings so the rest of the board can be aware of what those discussions are going, I think would be good, just so we can understand what's going forward there. Other thing I have was letters of interest for the Powhatan School Board representative will continue to be received until the close of business on Wednesday, January 27th. We'll have a public hearing at our next meeting on February 2nd for those who wish to provide thoughts and comments to the board on filling this position, and then we will schedule interviews for those for that position later. As has been mentioned, this is a county function, so the four members from the county are the ones who vote. City representatives are welcome to participate in the public hearing, as well as sit in on the interview process. But it's the county representatives that vote. So, just to make sure we're all clear on that. With that, I'll go into our upcoming meetings. Yes, ma'am. I guess.
You skipped me over.
I didn't skip you over, but you didn't say
what, that. Ram pride was my comment? Okay. okay, it was a great comment. Ram pride. Anyway, I just wanted to remind everyone about the survey on the main website so that parents will be able to make their, and teachers and staff, make their choices known as far as whether they want to go for a three-day Thanksgiving or the full week off between Christmas. So just wanted to put a plug that survey ends February 2nd.
Thank you, Mrs. Holm.
You're welcome.
With that, we'll go to upcoming meetings. February 2nd, here at the county at 6 o'clock, we have a closed session.
At 6:30, we will have a public hearing on the Powhatan District seat. Immediately following that, we'll have a work session with action items all here at the county complex in Building F. Their VSBA Capital Conference is February 10th in Richmond, as well as orientation for chair and vice chair, new board members on February 11th at the Richmond Marriott. So a few of us are going to Washington, D.C. this weekend for the Advocacy Institute for the NSBA. On February 16th, there's a closed session here at Building F in the county complex at 6 o'clock, and then a regular meeting to follow at 6:30. So with that, we stand adjourned. Thank you.